the bear is crying. Why is the bear crying?
But I have to
hashtag
say...
Hashtag Soshi fail.
I would love to do research on it, except that I don't think my landlord or my smoke alarm would appreciate it. My props are comforting me. Remember what I said about cheap price crap is still crap? It's whatever the heck comes out of my head and out of my rear.
Apparently somebody is going to be walking around as a giant gummy bear.
Does it have a bear trap?
I was thinking about that. I was like, should I type that in? Are you going to have the bear? No, that might be a little mean. I'm not going to do that.
Giant Teddy used ice breath.
Oh,
super effective.
Oh.
I'm going to make an attempt at it. I don't know if the magic juju beans will be in my favor there, but hey, it doesn't hurt to at least try.
Magic juju beans.
Yes.
Magic juju beans. Unlike Amber, who's going to have to bring her entire workshop with her. If you get the Walmart lightsaber, pillage the lighting components.
Pillage!
I would say borrow, but you're not giving them back.
No. Pillage!
Thanks, Amber. Push it good.
And now I have a triple. I've always wanted one.
That needs to sit on your desk at work.
So fudge you!
I will happily take fudge.
Yay, fudge.
Delicious.
We like fudge. We're very easily entertained. Just give us fudge and we're happy.
I am bribable with food.
Yay, food.
As long as it's good
fudge.
Oh, we're hitting loopy time.
Why do I feel like this is going like Flying Spaghetti Monster places?
Oh, dude, I have lots of pictures of the Flying Spaghetti Monster.
Why does this not surprise me?
It was a very epic Flying Spaghetti Monster. She was a very epic Flying Spaghetti Monster. It was a she, no
less. Sure she was.
And this is my favorite, Sexy Olaf.
Oh, I saw that. Hurt. It's so stupid.
So then the commercial's gonna be like, so, do you want to build a snowman?
Nope, don't want to build a snowman here. No.
And I don't, I love you listeners, I love you very much, but I'm not going to fry my machine for you. There will be things going on in the shed outside, in my yard. Things that may or may not end up on camera.
Just layering certain pieces to kind of give him a great presence. Is that your bread beeping?
Yeah.
The next trend in cosplay is that somebody comes up with, you know, stick-on eyebrows that are pre-colored.
That would be awesome. Oh my goodness.
Bye-bye.
Pre-colored, pre-styled.
Epic cosplay and art.
All I want is
get on that.
90% of the profits are media credit.
All of our wig makers need to get on that. Now start selling them as kits along with your wigs. Dyed to match eyebrows to go with the wigs.
Just trim them. The 11 things I have learned about Dragon Con. Be amazed and enjoy this mess.
Oh, M. Night Shyamalan, he never focused really much on story.
What is it with you and llamas? I just think it started with Shyamalan, actually. Every time I hear his name, I'm like, it's not Shyamalan, it's Shyamalama.
Sora years ago, like the black and white Sora, and it was just like taking Philadelphia cream cheese and just
slathering it on. Yep.
It was consistent, but like nobody could touch me. If you hugged me, it was coming with you.
So. Actually, I take it back. You are the evil one. I am pure white as the driven stone.
I am whiter than you are, lady. Don't give me that. I am the whitest of all white people in Whitington.
I knew by saying that comment I would get you going.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Because I know I'm the palest of Palington.
That pretty much covers it. Hey, Podders. We made it to the end of the third year of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Welcome to everybody new and old for this end of year celebration. Of course, it is also episode 79. We do have a special treat for you guys in store for this episode, as we always do for the end of year episode. But first, let's start off as we usually do, because tradition is very important on this show, of what we have been doing in the world of cosplay, or in some cases what we have not been doing in the world of cosplay.
I guess that means it's all me.
Well, I mean, I have a brief update, but you can go first because you actually have stuff to show.
I have stuff to show because I've been painting and working on, well, I used to have paint on my fingers, but I took it all off because, yeah, I think I need to make that a habit of just keeping my fingers painted because it seems like it happens to me on a weekly basis where it's like, hi, people, oh, I have blue fingers again. Okay. Well, hey, you can see a little bit. All right, anyway, I have been stuff that I've been working on. I've been working on all of my Warbla armor. Look at the shinies. So many shinies. So here's something that I have learned over the past week. Wood glue is a very fantastic thing if you need to, like, soften and make smooth Warbla, as this thing is bending all crazy-like. This thing is supposed to be, like, awkward, completely non-functional chest armor. It basically sits underneath my bust line and then goes down to my crotch. It's so stupid, it makes no sense whatsoever. But anyway, so Amber never told me about the wonders that is wood glue, and she's told me how... She's told me that it's a great filler, and she's talked about it on multiple occasions. I didn't realize that it could also be used to make things smooth and very, very even. So when I read a couple of tutorials and I tried it on this, I was like, holy crap, I don't have to sand anything. I don't have to really put any primer on this. I can just go with the wood glue, 2 to 3 coats, and then start painting. This is genius. Why did nobody tell me this before? You all suck. However, I did find that it's not so good on gauntlets because with gauntlets and because of, you know, gravity, and in fact you're having to slowly rotate and paint at the same time, it doesn't work quite as well. So I'm in the process of gessoing, however you want to say it. I'm doing that right now to kind of smooth out certain edges, but overall it's like, I made this. I am making stuff. How cool am I? I'm, like, actually making armor. Amber is going to be so damn proud of me when this is all painted and ready to go. She has no idea. This is, like, uber coolness. It's like, I'm doing this to make Amber proud.
Incidentally, if you have a couple spare styrofoam cones at home, you know, just cones, you can put your gauntlets on the cones and then do the wood glue thing from top down, because that way gravity actually helps you by pulling it down for leveling. You'll still get a little bit of droppage at the very, very bottom rim because that's gravity and that's wood glue, but you can just take a little cheapy foam brush and just, you know, grab it real quick. But that's what I do for mine. I put them on cones.
The only reason I didn't, there's actually two reasons why I didn't. It's one is because of the way this particular pattern is. I was afraid of the wood glue getting caught in weird spaces, and then you wouldn't see the cool little detail that I have going on between each section. The other thing is that the two styrofoam cones that I have are going to be used for my Amidala costume. That's going to have hair wrapped around it, and I really don't want to junk those up quite yet.
It doesn't junk them up.
You say that, but knowing me and my luck, that's probably going to junk them up.
Well, that's different.
No, my luck is not that great.
I can't vouch for you.
So I'm trying to play the safe card on that one. So it's like gesso, gesso, again, however you want to say it. That's what I'm doing with these suckers. But yeah, I've been doing that all week. I know some people are probably thinking, it takes you a whole week to do this. Yes, I've never worked with this crap before. I'm deathly afraid of making anything with armor. So I'm taking my slow-ass time to making sure these are near perfect so I don't screw it up. But while that stuff has been drying, I've been making aprons, so I'm not completely lazy. Amber?
Fair enough. My progress is not physical. It's more mental. We've gotten our craft room mostly set up in the house.
Woo!
Basically, things are where they will be for the most part, aside from having, you know, Christmas trees and whatnot in the way. So, you know, craft storage is set up. My craft cabinet is set up. The cutting table's already been used, so we've at least gotten that far. It's just a matter of getting all my materials organized now. I had to raise my bed up so, of course, I can throw more cosplay stuff underneath it, because heaven knows I have too much fabric. Not that any cosplayer has ever had that problem in the history of the world.
No, never.
So once I get everything so that I know where everything is, as opposed to having to go look in various rooms still, because there are still boxes I have not unpacked yet. So once that's settled, then I can actually, like, get going, because the first costume I'm going to work on is Cosmos from Final Fantasy Dissidia, for you Final Fantasy fans out there. I already have the materials. It's just a matter of getting down to business and doing it. I will have to make a muslin, to fit it just because of the nature of the dress. And Val has some spare material in her Etsy store that I may be picking up as well to complete it. Because there's all these little intricate details on the costume, you know, veil, sash, all sorts of good stuff. And I'm going to have to pattern out, likewise, very useless armor. It is very completely useless armor that she wears.
Yeah, it's like that for a lot of the Final Fantasy characters. It's just armor that's there to look shiny and pretty, and it makes no sense. Thank you, Square Enix.
So what I ended up deciding over the last week as I've gone through my things, I have retired Sif. I'm not going to remake her. I just, there's not enough motivation there for me to do it for the time being. I may do it in the future down the road, but she's retired. I'm not going to redo it. I've already chucked the armor because I could not save it. And I think I'm going to retire Athena as well from Saint Seiya. Yes, I spent all that time remaking her accessories. Yes, I agonized over the use of styrene to make these really intricate little bits. To be honest, you know, this is something cosplayers have to do. At some point, you have to sit and look at your costume and go, can I justify storing this for a year and rewearing it and maintaining it? And I can't. I can't really justify it, so I'm going to have to make the decision. I'm going to salvage what I can from the fabric, from the parts, gems, things like that, and just chalk it up to experience. You know, I got a lot of good experience making that armor. You guys got a tutorial out of it. I think it was within the last 10 episodes I did my armoring tutorial with that. So I'll just chalk it up to learning. Now I know what I'm doing a little bit better, and now I'll know how better to do it in the future, now that I know the pitfalls of working with styrene and heat guns and such. I need to finish Cosmos for AllCon, because I hope to, you know, as we are managing the cosplay contest for AllCon, I hope to have a nice costume to wear. And I'm going to have to spruce up, I think, one more to wear to AllCon, because at this point, as I'm getting older, for those of you who are older cosplayers, I think you've kind of been down this road that you kind of just want to turn over your entire cosplay menagerie and just start over. Because it's like, these costumes are getting kind of old. They're getting kind of ratty. To a point, yeah, they're in good condition, but as I get older, it's like, okay, I need fresh. I need newer stuff. I need stuff that fits now that my body's getting a little bit older, rounder, and such. So I think I may just end up retiring the vast majority of what I currently have. I think I'll keep Lena, because Lena's pretty much what I'm known for. I'll keep Umi for a little while, and I'll keep Arwen. And I think the rest are going to end up having to go. I'll keep Rava. But Rava's a special costume. Everything
that
else?
That one's super special.
Well, particularly with Legend of Korra. Oh, the feels. I'll talk about that in the after session.
Yeah, we have to wear those again. I've already had quite a number of people request that we wear those, and I'm like, okay, we'll figure out when. We'll have to like storm a Korra photo shoot. Because surprisingly, a number of people, at least on my page, were able to pick up immediately who the characters were. So we got to wear them.
AllCon, maybe?
Maybe. I don't know. Maybe.
For the costume contest. It can be
good. God, that thing's no, that's way too big and heavy. I plan to go as light as possible.
We'll figure out something.
Another round of April.
Yes, but that actually, as another cosplay update, for those of you who are thinking about attending AllCon, we will be managing the cosplay contest on Friday. So we would strongly encourage you guys, if you can get the time off on Friday to come and join us, it is Friday night. Please do. We highly encourage participation. We are broadening the contest just a bit for participation purposes. Right now, we are working on prizes. And we've got some pretty cool prizes. The trophies look awesome.
The trophies are so cool. Oh, my goodness.
The trophies are very cool.
I'm so happy with them.
And we are reaching out to various local vendors to see if they're willing to help sponsor the contest so that we can get cool things like casting supplies, maybe a gift card to Spark Fun Electronics, maybe something from ThinkGeek. You know, just little things that cosplayers and prop makers can make good use out of. So we're trying to make this as cool as possible, yet as relaxed and open as possible.
Absolutely. And I know most people know that they don't have that they can only sign up when they get to AllCon. We're doing it a little bit differently this year because it's on Friday. It only really gives you one and a half days to really sign up. Not a whole lot of time. So if you already know that you want to compete, head to AllCon's website, or you can head to our website. We have an online sign-up form right then and there, and within a week we'll send you a confirmation email saying, yes, you're in. I mean, pretty much we're letting everybody join because we want this to be an all-inclusive experience. So sign up, please, 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 please. Yeah, that's the whole point. It's in the name. It's AllCon. Everybody should be allowed to join up. So sign up, please. We'll have cool stuff to give away.
Yeah, sign up. Bring your friends. Tell your friends that they can also come and participate too. And children. Children
and children
are allowed to cosplay. Absolutely. In the contest as well.
Family-friendly show.
So hopefully we will see you guys there. I know that AllCon has a discount running on their tickets. They've got two different discount codes going right now, depending on when you purchase between now and end of year. So we would highly encourage those of you who have not yet bought your tickets, you may consider doing it, not just because we're doing the cosplay contest, but because it will save you a little bit of money since they're running a discount. And that goes for pretty much any convention that's coming up early next year. A lot of them run New Year's promotions on their tickets. So, 'tis the season to get your convention stuff in gear.
Absolutely.
Indeed. Speaking of end of year, we have had quite a year here at CosPod.
Oh, lordy, have we had a year. Whoo!
But we made it. We made it.
Yay. You know,
year 3, we are now toddlers. We were past the terrible 2s. And we honestly would not be here if it wasn't for you guys. I mean, we're pretty much just talking heads. We do this not for ourselves, because heaven knows we already talk to ourselves as we're crafting, so we can entertain ourselves. That's not a problem. Or we can.
Thank you for admitting that.
So, I never said we were sane.
No, we're definitely not sane.
But you guys are the ones that keep us doing this, keep us going, help provide us topics, help provide us content, give us feedback. You know, you guys are the ones who laugh at our antics and seem to be enjoying the show enough to keep downloading the show. So I don't know that there are words enough besides simply thank you. Thank you for doing what you do. Thank you for sticking with us, new and old listeners. And thank you in advance for those of you guys who are going to keep sticking with us, and we hope that everybody will. We're not planning on pod fading anytime soon.
You guys definitely keep us going, because without you all, we would just be Amber and Val talking to ourselves. We probably would have gotten bored with each other by now.
And I promise I will eventually have cosplay updates. I will have something interesting for you guys to see that don't involve, oh my god, my house is falling apart.
Right. Good stuff was going to happen in 2015. 2014 has been a lot of good things, a lot of bad things, a lot of mediocre things. So 2015, we're going to be thinking positive. Good stuff's coming next year. We got lots of cool things coming along.
Yes. So let's start out with what we enjoyed over the past year. So, for example, this past year, I became a big fan of Legend of Korra and Ruby. Enough to get me to want to cosplay from both of them.
Ha!
So, I really enjoyed being able to get back into certain shows again to kind of fuel my love of the cosplay art. And there were a couple of news items that actually really kind of intrigued me, and I know one of them recently was the Golden Age of Cosplay. Because it's healthy for us as a community to kind of think about where we are and where we're going. And it kind of made me think about my own, like, cosplay career. It's like, have I hit my own golden age of cosplay? Have I hit my cosplay prime? Or maybe my not-so-prime.
Or maybe an Optimus Prime. There you go.
Yes. Yes, because I am the good guys. I cannot be evil. I cannot be an Autobot. Therefore, I must be Optimus Prime.
So funny, because one of the things that I added in a montage is, I think it was either maybe 2 or 3 episodes ago, you made mention of something about how you're always a good guy and I'm always the bad guy. Of course that's in the montage.
That is usually the case. I am usually the good guy. Once in my life, I have cosplayed the bad guy and I was not very good at it.
It's so much fun being bad. It's so fun!
There's not an evil bone in my body. The few times in my life I've even tried to pretend that I was a jerk, I couldn't even come off as a jerk, even when I was trying to be one. I'm not a character actor. That's it.
Yeah, I see. I look at it as my way of kind of letting out all the things that I'm bottling up, because I think I'm a fairly nice person in person. I don't believe that I'm actually an evil human being. I really don't. It's only when I dress up like one that I let all that come out. And for me, that's kind of like my stress release. It's like, here's all the crap that I've been wanting to say for so long, but I know I can't get away with in real life. But if I throw on like my Sith costume, I can let it go. Literally and figuratively.
And the other thing that I appreciated the most from the last year, and we were part of this, is just the sheer explosion of tutorials that weren't anywhere near close to being accessible last year, so that now that cosplay is all over the media, all over the internets, there are memes about cosplayers everywhere. But now, pretty much anything that you would want to do that is a basic cosplay skill, you can find it on YouTube. You can find it on cosplaytutorials.com. You can find it on cosplay.com or AC Paradise. You can find it any number of places on the internet, and now they even have videos showing you how to do it. So if you want to learn anything from soldering to warbler to weathering to French seam stitching, all of it is now available for anybody of any skill level to see on the internet. And that really increased the reach of cosplay. That made me very happy. So bravo to all of you guys who are putting out tutorials on the internet for cosplayers. Thank you. Thank you for helping us advance the art. Thank you for making it accessible to those who want to join but may in fact be too afraid to try it.
Okay, so I guess what I am thankful for, I'm thankful for the community in general. As Amber mentioned, like the Golden Age of Cosplay article and things like that, that we're still able to have these type of healthy debates and trying to figure out where we want the community to go, how do we want it to grow, how do we want it to change, how do we want it to evolve, all those cool things. So in general, I'm thankful for the community and the fact that we can actively participate in asking ourselves these questions and talk about it and figure out who we are as people. And definitely, especially with this whole nerd ward culture and all this crap that goes on behind the scenes and Gamergate and video game crap and all this extra stuff, it's nice to have some place that I can go to and feel somewhat at home and still allow myself to think outside the box and still allow myself to have discussions of this nature. So that in itself is pretty cool. I'm also thankful for the growth of cosplay videos, but not in the normal sense. We've seen so many cosplay music videos in the past. I mean, they're just all over the place. But this year in particular, it has really grown. It has really changed. It's become more like documentaries and less about, you know, cosplayers showing off, you know, their pretty final work. You can actually see the behind-the-scenes stuff. You can actually see what goes on at the conventions. You can see what happens after the conventions. And the things like the PBS documentaries, and they've got a couple of those out now, Cosplay Boom, there's so many different websites, Cosplay With Me, they all do really cool stuff and talking with cosplayers of all ages, of all genders, of all types, from beginners to experts and everyone in between. And that to me shows growth in the community in a way that I had never anticipated. So I'm definitely thankful for that type of content that people are putting out there. And then last of all, I'm thankful for Amber, because Amber keeps me sane, as crazy as that may sound. Past couple of months have been nothing but a giant butt and a half for me. Hell, this past 6 months since Akon have been nothing but a butt and a half. And she keeps me sane. She keeps me going. She's laughing at me now.
Because I totally know the feeling of the last 6 months, just something crawled up fate's rear end and just...
It attacked us. It attacked both of us so horribly. And being able to come on and do this show every other week and having this to edit has really kept me sane. So, thank you.
I push her so far past the edge of insane that it loops back around and becomes...
Yeah, exactly. You have to do 360. As Stephen Colbert said on his last episode, you have to do a full round. So I'm right back at the beginning.
Yes.
I'll miss Stephen.
I did want to mention that Cosplay Boom is becoming a weekly series now, so that you guys can actually go give them a listen once a week as a podcast, or I think what they're calling it is a cosplay talk show.
Yeah.
And they actually have a YouTube channel.
that they do, which we are, of course, already, you know, subscribed and faved to. Yeah. Hey, I donate to them. So.
Yes.
It's a worthy project.
Their user ID on YouTube is simply Cosplay Boom, and that's all one phrase. There are no spaces or punctuation. It's just Cosplay Boom.
Mm.
And they have, their most recent episode was about The Hobbit, so that's actually in my queue to watch for tomorrow.
Amber's going to really love that one. That one's super cool.
I'm going to see The Hobbit on Christmas Day with my family.
Oh, that'll be fun. You enjoy
so,
that.
I am excited. I'm going in with a grain of salt, so I'm cool with that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know it's different from the book. That's okay.
Right.
I'm not a purist. So I'm really happy about that. But I actually had forgotten one of the moments that I remembered most from this past year, but this was simply because I'd never done it before, and that was being a guest at a con.
Yeah, that was fun. It was really cool to just see how you and Danny were for the first time, and I was just like, oh, I feel like I'm the expert and the elder here.
I know.
And you guys like newborn chickens.
It was the same way when we did the pro photo shoot with Rava and Vatu.
Yeah.
I had never done that before. I had a lot of firsts this year, things that I hadn't done before that I was invited to do, and it was just a whirlwind. I was just kind of flying through it by the seat of my pants, didn't know any of what I was doing, completely pulling it out of my rear end. But it seemed
to work out okay. That's in the montage,
too. It seemed to work out okay. You know, and I really did, I enjoyed both. I was a little intimidated by the photo shoot.
Sure, sure. As anybody would be for their first time, especially in a professional setting like that.
Yes, particularly since I'm not usually on camera like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have this, but it's not, there are not still photos of me floating around the internet somewhere. Now there are.
Oh, there totally are. And it's all over my Facebook.
Wow. Yeah, I know. You posted one just yesterday after Legend of Korra finished.
I got rid of your battery pack on the pack.
I couldn't help that.
I know you couldn't. I just thought it was funny. I was like, oh, right, the battery pack is there. I probably should
Photoshop use that for so many costumes that I can't spray paint it one color because then it would clash with whatever other costume I wore.
Exactly. Which is fine. So it's totally cool. It's just really funny that I was like, oh, right, I forgot that's why I didn't post this because of the battery pack. Oh, let's just get Photoshop out.
Yeah, which I did add a Water Tribe outfit, just casual outfit. Not necessarily one of Korra's, but based on those designs. So that I can have something comfy to wear. Because we'll talk about 2015 here in a little bit, but that's
right.
One of my goals, is to make comfy costumes.
Comfy costumes are good.
Yes.
April is like my go-to now. I'm like, whenever I can wear that, if I have to roll around on the floor, I'm totally going to wear that.
Yes. And one of the other things that we noticed over the past year is just how much we've grown as a podcast.
Unbelievably so. It's insane. Not just in sheer
stats.
Yeah, but we as people and how much we have changed and evolved since this podcast has grown. And hey, new equipment. Hey!
Yes, we have new equipment. Well, we have new-to-us equipment.
Right.
And we're actually looking at getting new equipment next year. Please work, give me a bonus. Please work, give me a bonus. Please. We could really use new equipment.
And my bonus went towards my car gas. Woo! That's my bonus.
You know, we have grown as people. We're a lot more confident in our ability to do the podcast on the fly. You know, we're no
Absolutely.
Longer scripted. We have no script at all.
I can't remember. I think the last time that we've done a script has been when we did PikminLink interview, because that was something where we wanted to make sure we had our questions down beforehand. But everything else, I mean, shoot. This one I did with Sparkle Pipsy was completely on the fly. I had no... I already knew in my head exactly what I wanted to ask her. I didn't have anything pre-scripted, pre-recorded. It was just all up here.
Yeah. And also, we've gotten a lot more proficient in our use of the equipment, so we can just set up, tear down, and that's that. We've gotten a lot better about being able to bring better pictures and better video to you guys as far as coverage goes in general. You know, I've definitely gotten a lot more proficient with our Canon. To be able to actually, you know, use it to zoom in gracefully, zoom out gracefully. Still having trouble with the tripod because it's not a full fluid head. But
yeah, there's only so much you can do with that.
We are a not-for-profit podcast. We do have to finance these things out of our own pocket. So at the moment, I can't really afford to get a nice tripod.
But that's okay. We make do.
Yes. And the other thing is that we've actually had a lot of growth in influence of all things, to where, you know, we're getting top level access at conventions pretty easily. We're able to get some big name guests to come in and donate their time to us so that they'll come and talk to us, which, you know, one of those is our interview later for you guys, that earlier we didn't think we could even ask these people. Like, we're not important enough to be able to get these kind of interviews. But now that we've been around for a little while, we're established, you know, we have a good fan base. Now we can actually bring you guys these things and have a little bit of influence on the community, which is actually really gratifying, because not that we don't want to, like, take over the community. We're not here to rule the world. We're not going to do that sort of thing. That's not what we're here for. We're here to open up the community and to get everybody to think. Think about, what is cosplay? Why are you in it? How can I make it more inclusive? How do I best portray the community to the outside world that may not be into cosplay? You know, that sort of thing. So that's we're using our powers for good. For the most part.
Mostly. Oh, good. Yes. I'm glad we both went on the same page there.
No, nobody needs to know that we're actually here to take over the world.
What do you want to do tonight, Brian?
Same thing we do every night, Pinky. Try to take over the world.
The Pinky and the Brain. The Pinky and the Brain.
We still should have been Pinky and the Brain cosplay.
That would be, I am totally fine with being Pinky. He's not my favorite, but I will totally be Pinky if you want Brain.
Narf. That's what I should call this episode. I'll just call it Narf.
Narf. Okay, I'm changing the title so it's not End of the Year Insanity, it's Narf. Remind me, because I'm going to forget.
We are insane, but it's okay.
Yeah, this is how we get by.
But, you know, we've definitely grown, and we've been really humbled and flattered by the number of people at conventions that actually approach us and say, hey, aren't you from CosPod? I love your show.
It still weirds me out when people do that. And
it is weird.
Even at, what was the last one that we went to? Oh, crap.
A&T.
Thank you. Even at A&T, there were two people where I happened to just be going to the bathroom and coming back out to go to the cosplay contest who stopped me and were like, hey, you look really familiar. Don't you guys do something online? And I was like, yeah, we're part of this podcast. Handing them our business cards. And they're like, oh, yeah, I've seen a couple of your episodes. And it's like, it's still strange and odd to me that people would recognize this in that way. I'll sometimes get people who maybe watch, like, my personal Facebook page, but not because of the podcast. So that still weirds me out.
And we're not saying it's weird in a bad way. So we're not saying, you know, that you guys are terrible. No. That's not it. We're just not accustomed to the fact that, in a way, we are kind of internet famous.
Yeah, the people recognize us, and that's just strange.
Yes, we're not accustomed to it, so we still are kind of trying to figure out how to react to it in a good way, because we're not accustomed to being any kind of famous, let alone internet famous. So
definitely not internet famous.
So it's not a bad thing. You don't have to stop doing it. Just
no.
If you come across a little awkward, it's still because we're kind of getting used to it, even after
it's
3 years.
It's still strange.
Yes. We do this for fun, so to be recognized, it's like, wow.
I mean, even things like being at Dragon Con and having Kamui recognize me, she was like, oh yeah, I remember you from the interview. It was like, that blew my mind. I was like, I was expecting her to completely forget about me, because it's just like, damn, that's how important we are now. How cool and weird is that?
All right. So, speaking of our growth over the last year, I do have our web stats.
Yay, I like this section. I'm a nerd. I like listening. I like the numbers.
So, first and foremost, we would like to say welcome to our new listeners. We actually did have a couple more countries hit our top 25 list, and that is awesome. You know, it's really cool that we have international reach with the podcast. So, we would like to say welcome to our listeners in Ireland, Romania, the Russian Federation, Netherlands, Morocco, Saudi Arabia, Lithuania, and the Ukraine. So welcome to you guys. Thank you for dropping by and taking a look at the show. of course, we don't want to forget all of our other listeners. These are simply, you know, new countries that have come online to have a look at our show. And we always encourage you guys to share our show. Even if you don't necessarily listen to all of it, you know, all the time yourself, if you just share our website link or share our feed, we're cool with that. You know, spread the love. We are all about that.
Spread in the love.
Yes. And since we're about two-thirds of the way through the month, we're still sitting at over 12,000 page views and over half a terabyte's worth of bandwidth. So we're doing very, very well. I mean, you guys have set a new bar for us, basically, in terms of downloads and bandwidth and just sheer number of website hits per month. We used to be lucky if we would hit 10,000. Now we're regularly hitting somewhere between 15 and 20. So that is awesome. And now our biggest month was July, which was our run-up to, or it was our denouement from Project Acon, and it was our run-up to things like San Japan, GlitchCon, and DragonCon.
Why'd you have to use the fancy word?
I didn't want to say something like Fallout, because that implies it was negative.
It wasn't Fallout. It was post-convention, pre-convention coverage. There we go.
Yes. So we had the biggest month was July, and that was over 40,000 hits. That was something.
Insane. That's bananas. Actually, while you're doing that, I'm going to look up our Flickr crap.
But the biggest surprise was our total for the year. And now bear in mind that we switched web hosts since our last year. So all of our stats are for 1 year, and that's it, just 1 year. So as soon as we switched web hosts over the last year, we have had 258,410 hits so far. And we've still got another 10 days.
That's pretty awesome.
So, and you guys have transferred over 100,000 files, so that's over 100,000 downloads of the show, which is really cool.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're hitting end of convention season, which, so we expect a little bit of a slowdown in traffic, but we also will pick things back up basically as soon as the new year starts. And I know part of the jump was because we had Kamui's interview last year, at end of last year. Each year, we're going to try and do something like big for you guys. You know, just to say thank you for listening to the show, here is our gift to you guys to say thanks. So our web stats are looking really good. I will say, while she is looking up our stats, that we did get our renewal bills for the website. So if any of you guys are still on the fence about donating to our website hosting costs, like I said, we don't ask for money 99% of the time. This is the only time of year that we do ask for donations. And our total bill is $114.88. That's quite a bit of money for hosting the website. And the reason it's that inexpensive in terms of maintaining the website is because we do all the work ourselves on the website. The only thing we pay for is the actual space from our web host provider, and to own the domain so that nobody else can overrun cospod.org like they did cospod.com. So if you guys are willing to donate, all of the money that we receive goes straight into our web hosting costs. It's going to go towards paying that $115 web hosting bill and domain bill so that we can hang on to our domain and keep hosting the website and keep giving you guys episodes. You know, we're not going to go down if we don't get donations. But it really, really does help us out. Even if you guys just give, you know, $2, $5, something small, even token amounts will help us out. So if you are willing, our PayPal is podcast@cospod.org. So again, that's podcast@cospod.org. We will accept any amount as long as, you know, it's reasonable. You know, we're not asking anybody to donate $500. Please don't, Alan. So, you know, we will accept if you guys are willing to help us out just a little bit. If you don't like PayPal, we understand. If you want to donate in other ways, say if you want to donate your time to the show by being a correspondent, we are looking for correspondents still between now and end of year. If you would like to donate your time by sending in tutorial segments, we certainly are cool with that as well. Or if you would like to donate, you know, in other ways, say helping us out with social media, you know, just give us a contact and we're happy to work with you so that we can help keep the show running as smoothly as possible, because It is only the two of us. We do have normal lives. We work full-time jobs. We're both trying to settle into living situations. So, you know, that said, you know, we are eternally grateful for you guys just for listening to the show. We're not going to be mad if you don't donate. Don't worry. We're cool. This is just for those who can. We do ask, you know, please help if you can. So, Val, do you have the...
I do, yeah. So for the Flickr stuff, it's a little bit more generic. I don't have exact numbers just because of the way that their stat system works, but I can still give a decent amount. What I can already see from what I've done at the beginning of the year to what I've posted at the end of the year, since getting my new camera and taking the nice fancier photos, our traffic has definitely increased immensely. There's a shock there. You can actually see pictures, and holy crap, I don't have to edit quite as many. So our Dragon Con photos to have the most amount of views, it's roughly just about 12,000 views. That's about, how many photos did I stick up there? 1,714 photos, so 12,000 people for 1,700 photos is an insane amount. After that is GlitchCon, of all things, which is only 153 photos, but we have about 5,000 views from that. And then ACON is shortly after that, and then Anime North Texas actually has about 3,000 views, which was kind of surprising. I think my choice in cover image probably helps out immensely. When there's a stormtrooper doing this next to a glass wall and there's a shark floating behind it, you kind of want to look at it. So it's kind of cool. I wasn't expecting as many people to be viewing Flickr as much. I know it's a little bit of an inconvenience, but I didn't want to upload 1,700 images onto our Facebook page, especially since not all of them are cosplay related. When I went to Atlanta, I like took pictures of other stuff around me too. So there's a lot of fishy photos in there, not really cosplay oriented. So I felt like Flickr was a good way to go, and I'm happy to see that people are going. That's cool. I'll just keep doing that then, and we'll reserve the Facebook for cosplay stuff. But yeah, we had lots of people looking at our stuff, lady.
Good, because we want to share the love around for
exactly.
All of those wonderful cosplays. You know, we're not going to discriminate whenever we put up cosplay photos. Incidentally, we don't discriminate by race, gender, sexual orientation, whether or not we think it's a good or bad cosplay, whether or not we think it's a well-made or a poorly made cosplay. We don't discriminate. The only time we don't post photos is if it is so blurry that you cannot see the cosplayer, or the cosplay for that matter, or if we are specifically asked not to post it.
Or we're asked to remove it. Something right. That Amber and I hold true whenever we do any type of cosplay contest is we try to get a photo of every single contestant, and we post it up there as best as we possibly can. And it hurts me when I can't post one because it's too blurry or you just can't make out the cosplayer, which it hurts me physically every single time I have to hit the delete button. So, yeah, we are all about inclusivity.
Yep, and I do the same with video, since I don't have a nice camera. I have a point-and-shoot, which does not take very good pictures. But we have our nice Canon, and sometimes it is very difficult when cosplayers are moving so quickly that the camera can't even focus on them. And then everything comes out blurry, and it's like, oh, I want people to see the details because this costume is so good. But the camera has to be able to sit and focus on you first. So, you know, we do our best with what we can, and we put up everything that is of decent enough quality, you know, photo-wise and video-wise, you know, as long as it's not blurry or we weren't asked to take it down, we put them up for you guys to see. And we put them up as quickly as possible so that you guys can enjoy it. So,
which is why there's 1,700 Dragon Con photos, because Val went into I don't give a crap mode and just started mass uploading everything.
Yes. And as far as next year goes, Val has her really awesome new point-and-shoot camera. Although it's not even a point-and-shoot. It's DSLR, I believe.
Yeah, it's a mirrorless camera, so it's about one step shy of a DSLR, but it's pretty freaking close because of the type of quality that it is. It's meant to be good for both movies as well as for photos. And actually, if you look at the most recent GlitchCon stuff, particularly for the cosplay contest, you can really see the difference between how the photos were from last year and how the photos were from this year. It's like night and day. They're so gorgeous. So yeah, I'm going to have lots of fun with my camera this year, particularly at AllCon. Oh, buddy.
We are looking into getting a Canon G20 for our video camcorder.
Lots of fingers crossed.
So we're trying to look for a good deal, because even as old as that cam is, because it is not the most recent model, they're already up to G30. But if we can find a G20 for a decent price, it's still going to be about $900 for just the cam body. That does not include any extra batteries, doesn't include extra SD cards, it doesn't include any sort of carrying bag or accessories. So, you know, these are plans that we have in 2015, so we're hoping that we can build up the funds so that we can get this equipment for you guys, because we generally don't use our equipment outside of the podcast. So it's not like we're buying these for our own personal use and then, you know, we're just taking your money.
It's definitely not that.
we use this equipment almost like 99.9% entirely solely for the podcast.
Mm.
The only times we do it outside is if we're actually filming like tutorials.
Which is still for the podcast.
Which effectively is still for the podcast. So there is that. So we'll be looking at that. I'm probably not going to upgrade my camera at this point just because it's going to cost me a lot of money to get the camcorder.
Yeah, exactly. And since I've got mine and I have my backup, so it's like we're covered on the photography stuff. That's not an issue.
Yep. We'll be trading in the XL1S that we've got. It will find a good home with a B&H photo. I'll have to ship it back somehow. I'll have to save one of my boxes from moving so I can ship it back.
I say, Orphy, if you need boxes, I got plenty of boxes since I've been Etsified for the past couple of months.
So besides equipment, looking ahead to 2015, I've got a really low convention schedule simply from buying the house. And I need to replenish my financial funds. And I need to fix basic things around the house before I can even look at having fun at conventions. As awesome as it would be for me to be able to go to, you know, all the different Dallas Comic Cons, San Japan, IkiCon, as fun as that would be, financially I can't justify it right now. I have other priorities that I have to take care of. So I have AllCon, Project AKON, and Texas Renaissance Festival. Those are the only for sure three that I will be going to. Anything else is entirely dependent on how much PTO I have at the time from my boss and if he's willing to give me off, how much money I have in the bank that is free for use, and or whether or not we are invited to be a guest at a local con, because that definitely helps with the whole financial thing. So anything else outside of that is just kind of up in the air. So if you ask me if I'm going to a con and I say I don't know, it's not because I'm trying to make you go away, it's because I genuinely don't know.
That's a very, very honest answer. Life has kind of taken turns for both of us, because I'm in the process of trying to get myself into a new job, something that actually allows me to utilize my degrees, plural, there's an S at the end of that, moving on with things in my personal life, things of that nature. So my convention schedule is also kind of limited. My plan is going PAX South, everything's already paid, so I have to go to that. I want to go to that, so that's done. AllCon, Project AKON, and then DragonCon, which has also already been all paid for. So it's not as many as I would like to attend, and I know most of them are pretty much in this region. But I think given how big three of those are going to be, I think it'll be okay. It'll be a lot of fun, and I had a blast at DragonCon. It was the most fun that I've had at a convention in ages, and I'm so looking forward to going back to it. But speaking of which, because we're kind of staying here in the southern region, segue, this is why we're having correspondence for next year. And you guys have already met Katie from Broken Mirror Cosplay. She's going to be our East Coast correspondent. She does a lot of stuff out there, and she teaches panels, and she does, you know, reviews and tutorials and all this crazy stuff, so that'll be good. We're still looking for ones for the North and the West Coast, but we've got a couple of applications. So at least, even though Amber and I can't make it around the country, especially me this year, this upcoming year, we're going to have people all over the place scouring for us. So that's going to be uber cool, and I am looking forward to that. I did not think that we were big or important enough to have correspondence.
We're like the Daily Show of the cosplay world.
Yeah, exactly. It's just kind of crazy to think, and I know this is something that we've talked about before, but we weren't really too sure if we were at that point where it's like, okay, maybe we should ask for outside help and like actually bring correspondents to be reoccurring members of the show. And the fact that somebody came to us and said, yeah, you guys totally should be doing this. It's like, okay, maybe we're ready now. Maybe we can do this. Maybe we can make this work. So I'm really looking forward to that content and being able to edit it and watch it. That's going to be a lot of fun.
And don't be discouraged for those of you guys that don't feel like you can commit to being a correspondent. Even if you attend a one-off local convention and get some video footage and some photos from it, if you're still willing to send us, you know, a little 5 or 10 minute review of the convention, we will happily accept them. You don't have to be a correspondent to send us content. You know, you guys are still more than welcome to send in tutorials that you've done or video reviews or even just photos from a convention that you've recently attended. We are more than happy to share that. You know, just contact us first, and the only reason I say that is so that, one, we can make sure it's family-friendly, because we are a family-friendly show, and two, so that, you know, we can give you the technical details, say the format of the video or the format of the photos that works most easily for us. That's all.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of it is just, you know, us being able to put our logos on it, because, of course, you know, everything needs to be centralized to CosPod. But you can talk to anybody that we've used their content before. We edit anything. We don't change anything around. We don't edit your words. We don't make it sound like you're saying something differently than what you had originally intended. And we make sure that we credit you fully. So if you have Facebook pages or websites or Tumblrs or whatever, we give you all the credit in the process. So if you're not too sure, feel free to talk to like the 20 people who've, you know, helped us in the past. Their submissions are pretty much accurate to its T. I don't think I've changed anything. I think the only thing I really do is I bleep out swear words. That's about it.
I think
that's the extent of my editing.
I cropped a cover photo once, but I actually took the photographer's logo and I moved it so that it was still at the bottom of the picture. Just so that they would still get credit for having taken it.
Right.
Just because the photo was too wide and I couldn't like resize it without it looking really disproportionate. So I just chopped off the edge like wide theater style, and I was just like, yoink, yoink. So we do still work to actually like keep you guys as having the credit.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yep. So as far as that goes, do you have any specific costumes you're looking forward to in 2015?
All of them.
Thank you.
I know, I'm very helpful, aren't I?
Good job, Val.
I know, I'm superb like that. I don't know. I don't know, because all of my costumes are going to be challenging in their own unique ways. So I'll be happy when they're done, and I'll be happy to wear them, and then promptly stuff them into my closet and not wear them ever again, like I have a really bad habit of doing. I don't know if there's any one in particular that I'm looking forward to more than the rest, and I mean that truthfully, because there's just something unique that I love about each individual piece that I'm happy to start working on and get done. I mean, heck, Evil Queen's already done 5 months in advance, so that's what I'll wear to the cosplay contest. I'll do the Evil Queen. That's easy to wear, easy for me to walk around in.
Nice.
Done.
So we'll have Evil Queen and White Queen.
Yeah, I'm cool with that, if you're cool with that.
Awesome. Assuming I get this done.
Assuming you get it done, yes, because we know you're a very busy lady.
Yes, and I'm also trying to make another career change.
Yeah.
Trying really, really hard.
Yeah. I feel you, sister.
I've only got four costumes currently on my list, because one's in progress from last year. But I have Cosmos,
mm-hmm.
and then I have two Pyrrha costumes from Ruby. I have her dress and her armor, and then I have my Ranger that I've been working on for the past year. And outside of that, everything else is pretty much up in the air. I've kind of stopped setting deadlines just because I end up not meeting them, and then I end up like getting partially through a costume and having to basically put it away because I don't either have motivation or time or materials to work on it if I don't make that deadline. So it just ends up, I end up having 4 or 5 different cosplays in various stages of progress that are all just sitting there.
I've noticed, and I've seen this on a couple of people's Facebooks and Tumblrs recently, that as we've gotten older, we're less likely to be setting deadlines on ourselves, and it's just kind of going at our own pace. Whereas I'm the exact opposite. I'm still setting deadlines. Like, I know exactly when everything needs to be done, but I'm also very a scheduled person, and I need my schedules. I get really cranky when I don't have a schedule.
My schedules never did work. Between not being able to work on anything realistically at my job and then getting home. I mean, by the time I'm done with work, with commute and everything else, and then eating dinner, if I'm lucky, I will have 2 hours a night to work on cosplay, and that's if I don't have something else that I have to be doing, like practicing for a symphony gig or doing chores around the house or errands or anything else. And so it's like, the older I get, the more life gets in the way of me being able to even have a schedule. So even if I had a schedule, I'd be sitting there constantly changing it because life would get in the way.
Yeah, like this is the result of insomnia. This is why it happened, because otherwise I'm in the same boat as you. I have my normal 8-to-5 job, but I do other things on the side. I do a lot of freelancing for marketing and social media and stuff to kind of build up my resume, and I have been for the past 2 years. So I've got all that going on, plus this. So realistically, I have maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours to myself, and by then it's like I just want to crash and not think. So then I sleep for about 3 hours, and I have insomnia, so then I start making armor. That's how I work.
Insomnia has never been a problem of mine.
Insomnia is it's an interesting equalizer. It allows me to do more work, but it keeps me tired constantly. So, you know... I'm not going to take Ambien, so nobody suggest that, please.
I wanted to introduce something to the listeners, and you know about this because I spoke to you about it yesterday, and I posted it on our Facebook page.
I got to re-download that. Remind me.
Dealing with 2015 costumes, there's actually a new app that is in the iTunes Store, or what they call the App Store, and the Google Play Store. So it's both for Apple and Android users, and it's called Cost Planner. And let me see if I can bring this up here. There we go. All right, so it looks a little something like this. You've got a list on the left-hand side. It's got all your different costumes. And then you can basically program in what it calls cosplay elements. So they're all the little components or the checklist of things that you have to do in order to finish that costume. And I believe you can also add the materials that you need to get for the costume. So you can check off as you get all your materials. You can check off your tasks as you do them. And it basically will monitor, as a percentage, the completion of your tasks and the costume overall. And it's used as a planning tool so that you can kind of pace yourself and figure out what it is that you need to do, what it is that you have done, and what you need to do to be able to finish your costume. Yeah.
Just for a second, I'm going to screen share exactly what it looks like, so it's a little bit more clearer, but there you go. So there's the screen share of it. And it's kind of, I don't think it's really changed since it was initially released. I initially had downloaded this, but I was like, it's not quite as detailed because I like my whiteboard. I have two giant whiteboards that are stuck on my door. But that's essentially what you're looking at. And it's not that bad. It's simple. It's easy to use. I could definitely see it being something where if you have a list of materials that you need to purchase and you want to keep track of all of that and see, okay, have I bought this yet for the costume? Have I bought that yet for the costume? I could definitely see that being very handy when you're going to, like, Joann's or Michael's or wherever.
The only thing that it – the two things that it does not do, and the big one is the calendar.
Mm-hmm.
It does not allow you to track dates. You are allowed to program in a starting date, but it doesn't allow you to program in, say, a due date.
Right.
So you can't track it as though it is a task manager. It's more of just a checklist. So you'll have to kind of pace yourself, or if you have coding or programming ability, then you may be able to use a third-party app to be able to integrate it into a calendar. Or you may just have to use the calendar on your phone or tablet.
Mm-hmm.
So that is one downside. The other is that it doesn't allow you to necessarily track budget.
Yeah, that was another thing too that got me.
So you can't necessarily say, I have X amount of money to spend on this project, here's how much I have spent thus far, or, for example, say, track sales at certain places and say, well, Michael's has chiffon for this much, Joanne's has it for this much, Hancock has it for this much. Oh, hey, it's on sale at Hobby Lobby. I should go get it there. It doesn't allow you to track any sort of financial activity on it, which would be helpful in a way. So, you know, for those of you who have been using the app, you may wish to contact the author of the app and let them know that you would like these things to be added. You know, add calendar capability, add budget and or financial capability tracking to this app. Because that would be really helpful to us as cosplayers. I'm grateful they have it the way it is. I'm really glad that they do have it. It would be awesome if it could get even better.
Yeah, it's good for a basic starter app. They just need to build on top of it. I think that's where donations would have to come in handy.
Donations and also letting the author know, because if nobody says anything, then no one's going to know.
Exactly.
But it looks
like a cool little app.
It's a very decent little app. It's worth a download, even if you just sit there and play around with it, you know, just to see how it works, especially those of you who have quite a few costumes coming up for convention season. So that could definitely help. It may even help, you know, if the author could allow you to categorize it by not necessarily deadline, but say if you had a certain convention that you were trying to intend it for, so that you could just select that convention. It would bring up a list of all the costumes that you have in mind. That'd be cool, too. Just little ways of improving it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, we have rambled on long enough about this past year and what we expect for the new year. Which do we have first, the interview or the montage?
Montage has already happened. Montage opens everything up. So now we're at the interview.
All right. So, without further ado, we present to you guys our interview with Li Kovacs, who is formerly known as PikminLink. We hope you guys enjoy. Welcome to our end-of-year interview, which, as you guys know, we always try and do something extra special to thank you guys for being our audience and for downloading the show. And so this year, we have invited Li Kovacs, who was formerly known as PikminLink, to join us for our end-of-year interview. So thank you very much for joining us. Yay!
Yay!
Applause.
Thank you for having me. It's awesome.
So for those who don't know you, if you would, please tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got into cosplay.
I started making costumes, like, way before everything else. It's like Halloween, and I wanted to dress up. And so basically, it started from there, and it turned into an obsession, like, everything. And then, in, like, 1998, I decided to make a Link costume from Ocarina of Time. And after that, I wore it for Halloween the following year. And since then, I think I wore Link for like multiple Halloweens after that, and it was just keep revisiting the outfit, and so I just kept working at it and kept making it better. So yeah, I've been like doing costumes for like almost like 15 or no, like more than 15 years now. It's like 16. Oh, where'd my life go?
You're a cosplay elder just like us.
Oh, how long have you guys been doing it?
Oh my goodness, I'm still fairly young. I'm only 7 years.
I'm on 16.
You're like, I'm only 7 years. It's like, come on, that's still like a long time.
That's still a long time, though.
That's pretty cool, though. So, but yeah, it's kind of weird to meet people that have been doing it for so long. Because I'm going to cons now, and I'm meeting people who just got into it and everything. And like back in the old days, I would know people was like, yeah, I've been doing it for like 3 years, which is like the babies back in that time. Like it was like 2004 and everything. But now it's like you actually meet the people who have been doing it for that long. It's like, that's right. We all have been doing it for that long. It's so nuts.
We were doing it before. It was cool.
Well, see, I'm going to be old. I'm going to be this old person, and I'm going to still be making costumes. I'll be making costumes of all the old people. So
that's the ideal. It's like you get to the point, and like I already can think of like a ton of Studio Ghibli characters who are like elderly or like at grandma level, and I'm like, I'm going to start cosplaying all those.
Oh, my God.
Well, plus there's now Naruto, Bleach, you know.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead, Belle.
All right, so since we know you mostly for your Legend of Zelda costumes, what drew you into that franchise?
I've been a Legend of Zelda fan since I was little. I've always been into video games, and like with the original NES, the Game Boy, and going up from that. And Zelda's just been my favorite series that has just stuck with me throughout my whole entire life. And I know at one point, halfway through my life, my dad was like, oh, it's just a fad. You're going to get over it. You're just going to, you know, you're just going to get out of these phases and everything. And it actually has not. It's gotten worse. It's just like, I have the freedom to collect everything I want now. Or at least try to. Because back then it was harder. Especially when you're young. It's hard to, like, get your parents to buy you everything. But now it's like, I'm working for everything, so.
But, yeah. Now we know that you do a lot of Link costumes. Is he your favorite character, or do you have another one?
He's pretty much my favorite character, but then again, it's kind of like anyone from the Zelda series is like my favorite. Princess Zelda herself is obviously my favorite, and I didn't start doing her until like a couple years ago when I did God of Zelda, and then I did Hyrule Warriors Zelda this year. But I was just like, no, she's way too good. I can't bring justice to that until like, I don't know. I guess I finally did it. So I was like, it's my time to break out of that shell and make Zelda. But then again, it's like Mario has always been my favorite too, growing up. And so
speaking of that, the Mario dress is adorable, by the way.
It's so cute! Oh my goodness!
Times 10.
Thank you. I was like, when I was designing that thing, I was just like, I want to make it look really nice, and I saw like a lot of other like Zelda outfits, and I made that again for Halloween. And then you know you go to the spirit stores and see the really bad ones. They're like, here's, like, whatever her name, Maria, and her friend, like, Lucy, or some Lucy, whatever it was. It was, like, the really bad, like, you know, costumes that are made of all these different characters. And I was like, oh, they made it look really bad. That's what I don't want to do. And so I was just trying to figure out a really nice, classy way of presenting Mario. And I was like, there's no way I could pull off his actual look, so I might as well try something else.
You definitely did it quite well, because it's such a cute and adorable little dress, and I see more people are copying that now and trying to do the same thing. You started a trend.
Yeah, I'm noticing a lot more people are doing it too, and it's actually really exciting that actual people are going out and doing, like, making their own version instead of going out and buying the costumes that you could just easily buy. And I like that. It's really cool to see.
Are there any other series or franchises or video games that you want to start cosplaying more from?
Oh, yeah, there's tons. One of the ones I've been wanting to do for ages has been from the Fable series. Oh, my God, I love Fable so much.
Fable's so great.
and ever since, like, the first one, I've been wanting to always do Fable, and then it's, like, more and more you can customize, like, your characters and your colors and stuff like that. It's like, I'm going to make my character, I'm going to do this, and I never do. And then, so Fable Legends is coming out, and I really want to do Inga from that. Like, her Inga's the one with the blonde hair and massive shield. And I see that, and I was like, oh, I want to do that. That's my dream costume for now from Fable. And then I have tons of series that I like. And then Bayonetta. It's like, I've been, oh, my God. Bayonetta is just like, you can't even describe it. It's just so full. It's just amazing to all the different levels. But I've been wanting to do her outfit since the first game came out. And I have never done it. And then the reason behind that is because the fabric is so hard to find. And her suit isn't just a solid black. It's actually a black and a dark gray. Mm-hmm. And to find, like, a nice, like, stretch, you know, vinyl or feather or, like, even leather in, like, that nice color is really, like, difficult. So I was just like, yeah, I'll hold it off. And I kept holding off. And then they're like, by the way, here's Bayonetta 2. I'm like, wait, what? They're like, you don't know what she looks like yet. And I was like, wait, now I have to wait like half a year to see what she looks like? Aw. And then they debuted her. I was like, aw, I'm glad I held up. I like her looking too better. It looks so, I feel like the look she has in Bayonetta 2 just really defines her as who she is as a character. The first one looked kind of nice and everything, but I felt like it was just very simple looking. But her new one's just so like, I don't know. It's like, yeah, like Bayonetta's of her level, and that's like the outfit. So yeah, I'm on a hunt for the fabric still. I found the black, though. I just got to go back to the website wherever I found it at and then reorder it because I was just like, yeah, I found it, never ordered it, closed all my websites. Oh, no. Where is it? a horrible habit, but...
I would be super thrilled if I saw you as Bayonetta, because I'm a huge Bayonetta fan. I've done that cosplay as well as Jean, so I understand the difficulties. Yeah, it's a challenge. It is a challenge.
The details that she has on her second outfit in Bayonetta 2, the silvery details on like her, her like top piece and her bodysuit, I plan on embroidering all that.
Oh, wow, cool.
I was just like, I tried to think, what else can I do that would make it look good? But the more you look at it, it's so obviously embroidered. And I'm just like, oh, please don't do this to me. I know I'm going to be sitting there embroidering this thing and just crying the whole entire time as I'm doing it. Like, what did I give myself in pain? 5 years later, it's done!
It's done!
Bayonetta 4 is already out. What? No!
There's nothing wrong with cosplaying old school. All right, so you've been a cosplayer for a little while now. Since you started, have you seen yourself grow or change as a cosplayer?
I've definitely seen my skills grow. And I think, I guess that saved me as like as a costumer and stuff to grow. And over time, see, a lot of people think that, like, oh, you probably already know how to do this stuff just by looking at it or something. But even to this day, every single outfit I have is still completely, like, start from scratch, trial and error. It's like maybe one method worked for one thing, but it's not guaranteed that it's going to work for something else. And it's just interesting because you learn so many techniques throughout the time. It's actually funny because you kind of start to forget some of them. It's like, wait, wasn't there like a different way of doing this? And then after you already make it, then you're like, oh, I could have done this that way. That would have been so much easier. But in making costumes, it's just trial and error, regardless of how long you've been in it and stuff. I'm sure like big professional like costume designers and movie places also go through the same entire thing. You know, they probably be like trying to like reference all their different methods and stuff. Yeah.
So what has been your source of inspiration? What keeps you motivated and keeps cosplaying?
The finished product, honestly, is the whole entire thing. It's the whole entire thing of like me being like, oh my god, this character is so awesome. I want to make that outfit. That outfit's so cool. And then, you know, you're like blood, sweat, and tears throughout the whole entire thing. But it's honestly like the whole entire just finished product is what keeps me going. It's like, I want that. I want to make that. And it's like, well, you got to work for it. It's like, oh, fine. I love it. It's like you just end up doing it, but it's the whole entire thing, because like I've always had this whole thing of like, I mean, being little, and you know, everyone has this, it's like they're like playing make-believe, they have like, they're like, I wish this character was real. It's like what kids go through when they see like Mickey Mouse at like Disneyland and all that stuff. It's like seeing that, I've always felt like these characters are so awesome, it'd be awesome to like bring them to life in any way or form that I could. And so it's just like just finishing all that and then doing off these cool photo shoots and everything to make them look like they're really set in their world and all that. That's my favorite thing of it all.
So from that, how do you decide what costumes you want to make?
I have a huge list already of things I want to make because there are a bunch of characters that I really like. A lot of them involve like Link and different Zelda characters, and then of course, Bayonetta's on that list. Finishing Lucina's on that list. And then I randomly start working on Mars without finishing anything else. So it's like I have like this list of incomplete costumes. And then I just shuffle back and through. But then it's like I get like this whole like little boost thing. Like, oh, I want to make that character now. So I bumped them up on my list. And it's like, and then I'll go back to playing an old game. I'm like, no, I want to finish that costume now. Yeah, that's how my thing becomes never ending. I eventually finished something. So.
Now, you mentioned this before. You said the Fable costume. Is that your dream costume now, or is it something else?
That's one of my dream costumes. I think everything that I've been planning for a long time has become the dream costume thing. So Bayonetta and a Fable-related outfit, for sure, is definitely a dream. And honestly, I wish I could just use a mind power and just have these costumes make themselves, because that would just make my life so much easier. Like, yeah, I could probably open my list to new things. I know another one of my dream costumes that I've been wanting to do forever, Samus from Metroid. And it's just like, I feel like I'm not up to skill yet to tackle that, but I feel like I might be. But I feel like mentally I'm not. So I don't want to go through that yet. So
is it the full Metroid armor?
Yeah.
Awesome.
And one day I will do that. I love Metroid. I remember playing that when I was little. Nintendo just makes these memorable games, which is why probably I'm so drawn into all their characters and everything. And it's probably a whole entire like nostalgia feel too, because I've been playing Nintendo since I was little. And so it's like to bring these characters that I played when I was little to life and like creating their outfits would be so sweet.
All right, speaking of Nintendo, now we get to have the fun question. So I know, and I was following you as you were live tweeting for the Game Awards. How much were you spazzing about the new Zelda content?
A lot. I was spazzing a lot. I had to stop myself from spazzing out because I knew if I would have done it, I would have missed like the whole entire thing. And I was honestly not expecting that to happen because it's like, come on, since when does Nintendo show something that big of a thing? At like an awards show, you know, I would expect that at E3, and then that's when I'd be waiting for it. But then it showed it at the awards show. It's like, wait, what? And like Reggie's like, we have something for him. I'm like, what? You have what for us? It's like, no, okay, wait, what is this? But it was so cool to finally see it in action instead of like that video. Because even though that video was so amazing that they showed last year at E3, it's like seeing it finally in action is just like, oh, it's so pretty. I'm so excited for it. Like, I'm seriously stoked. I know I'm going to be spending my whole entire time just roaming the whole entire land in that game and not even, like, doing the missions or anything. So, like, I'm just going to go scout around, check out some cool places.
Yeah, I think...
As soon as that game comes out, I'm off the radar. No one's going to ever find me again.
Yeah, I think I dubbed it, like, Legend of Zelda Photo Quest because it just looks so pretty that I'm going to spend the entire time screen capping stuff.
Oh, my God, that's what I'm going to be doing, too. It's just going to be so pretty. And, like, I know it's Epona in the video, and she doesn't look like what she normally does with the white mane and all. But it's just, I feel like, going to that, I feel like Epona can be reincarnated or reborn as any kind of horse. Because I think Epona's supposed to be Link's, you know, horse in general, regardless of what she looks like.
Right.
But to see that hair on Epona, like, flow and everything while she was running around, I was like, it's so pretty. And thank goodness for, like, making horses not run into trees, because that is so annoying every time I play a game. Like, go around the tree, no, stop hitting it, no. And you take, like, 5 minutes trying to just get around trees. Because it's, like, and it's kind of neat, because in a way you might think, it's like, oh, that's just a cheat, you're not going to hit a tree. But it's like, no, you could go ride a horse, and they won't run into trees. So it's almost like they gave the horse themselves, like, its own, you know, its own, like, AI. And it's just, like, it's really cool. That game is so pretty.
We're all eagerly anticipating it.
I'm so excited for it. I just want it now. But then I don't. Because, no, it's not done yet, so I don't want it now. It's like, make it perfect.
Have you already planned any costumes for it yet from the footage?
Oh, yeah. I've already been planning the Link from it since the last E3. But I know there's been tons of people that have already done it and everything. But I'm just like, I'm still holding out in case there's some little detail that slips up that you couldn't see in all the other images and everything. I'm just like, no, I really hate remaking costumes. And so I was just like, nah, I'd rather wait it out.
Okay, I think we are on to our fun questions. We ask these of all of our interviewees. What is your favorite material to work with?
Fabric-wise, it's probably linen, because I really like linen. It just works so well. You could, like, cut it and sew it and everything. It just works perfectly. And then in general for regular materials, I would probably say I like making props more than actual sewing outfits. So when I think of materials, I'm thinking probably resins and stuff like that, casting materials. Love working with casting stuff. I love casting things. It's like making like hundreds of pieces of the same thing. But yeah, probably that.
Okay, and then what is your least favorite material?
That is probably, what's it called? Chiffon.
Really? Aww.
I hate working with it. I like it when it, I love chiffon, and I love using chiffon for a lot of things, but when it's like, oh my god, that would look perfect in chiffon, sure, I'll go do it, and then I have to set the song. So I was like, wait, I have to sell this now? Aww. I don't want to do this. I hate sewing chiffon. It's just so annoying. I hate cutting chiffon, too. Especially when it tries to shift around. I'm just like, no, you stop that. To, like, spray adhesive.
Pretty much temperamental.
Down the ground, just stick it down, tack it down.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, it's a very temperamental material, even though it's so pretty. And it's like, it you really want to is. Use it for everything.
Yeah, it really is. It's like one of those hard-to-get materials. It's like, you know you want me, now you got to work with me. Oh, chiffon, it's a love-hate relationship.
Okay, so here's a fun question for you. If you could live in one of your costumes forever, which one would it be and why?
Oh. Oh, jeez.
I'm not so having to worry about bathing or washing or any of that stuff
I'm
that
so
never happens
to show. Neither, because it's like, which costume do I have that's comfortable to actually live in? Because everything else is like, I don't want to stay in this for like another 2 hours. What do I have that is comfy?
The plight of the cosplayer.
I'll probably go back to Mario. Because that looks like something that I could wear on the street and not get too oddly looked at, you know, or anything like that. And it's also really comfy. So, okay, I'll stick with Mario for that one.
Okay.
Okay, and then our final question. What advice do you have for news cosplayers? News cosplayers? New cosplayers. There we go.
Cosplayers. It's like, I'm going to be a news reporter, and I want to cosplay for it, so how do I...
There you go, exactly.
new cosplayers. A lot of people expect things to work out right away. And, like, I've had people come to me who are like, I want to make this costume. It's like a very, like, huge, detail-oriented costume that just involves a lot of work, and they've never done anything before. And my advice is to always work within your skill level. And if you really have no idea how to tackle something, then that's probably not the time to tackle it, honestly. Because even if I'm just like, I have no idea how I'm going to do that, I'll just go work on something else until then. It's easiest, it really is honestly the easiest to just start in the bottom and work your way up. It's always probably the easiest for that. But hey, if you know how to do everything right away, like go for it, you know, tackle yourself. What I've always liked about costume making is challenging myself to make something. But it's also that whole entire trial and error. And the whole entire thing as well is like just not giving up what you're doing. Because if you're doing something and it's not working out, don't give it up. But you could put it to the side and like hold off on it until later, like take a little breather space or something. But don't completely give it up, because it's probably, you know, you just need to really sit down and think of how to do something. But never give something up and just keep going at it. And if you're really passionate about doing it, you know, you're going to do it. So have fun with it. That's the other thing, too. People like, see, unlike me, I stress. I cry. I have tears and all that stuff happens. But it's like I still have fun with it in the end. It's the actual building part where I'm just like, I don't want to do this anymore. But, it's fun, though. I mean, obviously, I'm enjoying it in some way, or else I wouldn't have been doing it for, like, 16 years.
Yeah, exactly. We would still keep doing this if we weren't, like, pricking ourselves with blood daily. But you know what? We enjoy it.
Yeah.
It's an offering to the cosplay
guy. Horrible. I forgot what... Oh, yeah, it was Hilda that I was working on. I pricked my finger because I had to put so many pins in it. And I kept pricking my finger nonstop, and I ended up getting, like, blood on her white cape thing. I was like, no. And luckily it was like on the top edge area, so I was just like, no, I'll just surge it and no one will see it, maybe. And yeah, you can't see it. So I was like, yeah, so much tears went into that costume. Just like Zelda. Oh, so much tears when everything went into that costume.
But it turned out so well, it was worth it.
Thank you. Yeah, that's usually what it is. It's the end product that makes it worth it for me. But then sometimes you run into the whole issue of, like, I made a costume, I just spent all this time into it, and it turned out looking really bad. Like, I've had that happen before, and I'm just like, no, I'll come back to it later. 5 years later, maybe I might go back to it. I don't know. Eventually I do.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good advice.
I never see it as like a whole like time wasted or anything like that. I see it as like I just gained some experience from that. I learned something. I'll just move on to something else. So.
Yeah. I would agree. That is really good advice for new cosplayers. Never give
Absolutely.
Up. Never surrender.
Really? You went there?
I knew it. I just had it. I had it in my head. I was like, someone's going to go there. I just know it.
I'm obliged to. You put it on a silver platter and handed it to me. I'm obliged to go there. But Li, thank you so much for being on the show with us today, and thank you so much for sharing, you know, a little bit of insight into your cosplay. We really appreciated having you today.
Yeah, thank you so much for inviting me to this. It was a lot of fun. My first Google Hangout too. So,
before we let you run off, do you want to plug your website, your Facebook, whatever you want? Plug it here.
Oh, okay, sure. My website's very easy. It's LiKovacs.com. And then my Facebook, I recently changed my URL on that, so it's LiKovacs.official. And then my Twitter is LiKovacs. Everything's just LiKovacs, sorry. But you can access all of that from my website, so makes life easier. So.
Yep. What is your next convention coming up? Do you know?
I actually don't know. Okay. I know for a fact it's Emerald City Comic Con because I already got the badges for that. That one for sure, and then SoccerCon for sure, and then everything PAX, everything else up to that is just like up in the air. I don't know yet. I feel like it's gotten to that point where it's like, nah, it's too early to decide. Oh, there's a con next month? Okay.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you again for being on the show with us. And if you guys want to see more information, you can always go visit Li on her Facebook website and all that good stuff online. So thank you very much.
Yay!
Yay, thank you!
Yeah, thank you!
Hey everybody, welcome back. We hope you guys enjoyed our interview with Li. It was a pleasure to have her on the show, so thank you very much again, Li, for donating your time to us. And of course,
squeeing on Link!
Of course, we will strive to bring you guys another big interview for the end of next year as well, so if you guys have suggestions for us, then please feel free to let us know. Because this episode is going to release on the 27th, we would like to say happy holidays to our listeners. You know, Merry Christmas for those who celebrate it. Happy Kwanzaa. Happy Hanukkah. You know,
happy Festivus.
Happy Festivus.
Whatever.
Happy Saturnalia.
Yeah.
For all of the different holidays, we hope that you guys have a wonderful holiday. We hope that it is full of fun and cheer, that you guys are able to get motivated for the new year, and that everything has ended well, and that everything starts well. So in advance, we would also like to say happy 2015, happy new year. We hope everybody's new year starts off fantastically. Please be responsible if you do, in fact, enjoy a beverage or two that involves alcohol. We wish to have all the come back in one piece in the new year. You know, be safe on the roads out there. And we will see you guys next episode in 2015. And just real quick, again, if you guys would like to donate to the show, our address on PayPal is podcast@cospod.org. That is also where you can email us. You can also tweet us. We are at CosPodcast. We are CosPodcast on YouTube. We are CosPodcast on DeviantArt. And I believe we are Cosplay Podcast on Gmail if you guys wish to message us via the G chat. And, of course, you can always chat with us on Facebook, where, of course, we have always been CosPod.
The one place where we can be CosPod.
We always welcome interaction with you guys at any time. You know, even if it's just to say, hey, we enjoy the show. Can you guys talk about this? We're cool with it. So if you guys have any topics that you'd like us to start out the new year, please do let us know. We do welcome suggestions. And we hope to see many of you guys in 2015 at all of our conventions. Keep safe, keep warm, and stay happy. We will
Thanks,
see you guys
everybody.
Later. Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Happy 2014 and happy 2015. I haven't hit stop broadcast yet, so let's stay in. Anyway, I think this is where we need Google effects. This is like the worst timing for Google effects because now it's got to download and load up. There's his head. Where? His eye. Where's the sound? There is like no good sound that would go with this.
Yay!
There you go. You get a fanfare. Bye, everybody.